Hello guys, this is Harpreet. So guys, this video is going to be very informative. It is a recorded video of one of our students who just appeared for the role of security and routing switching interview. To maintain the confidentiality, we are not disclosing the employer, company and candidate information. But guys, you will get the insight like what kind of questions he was asked. He basically appeared for the profile where he was expecting the package like more than 20 lakh, and he cleared the interview. So I hope guys you will like this video. So let's jump into the recording.
So where are you basically from?
Yeah, I'm from Punjab. So like, so I have like a 9-year experience like working on networking domain, like routing, switching, firewall. So I have a like good experience on multi-vendor like Cisco, Juniper, Huawei, even FortiGate, Palo Alto, and Cisco ASC firewall. In my previous organization, like my day-to-day work, managing the firewall, doing the troubleshooting and configuring the routing protocol like BGP, OSPF, and I have also like a good experience on the Wi-Fi also.
Okay, yeah. So which all organizations you worked for?
Previously, I was working in Tech Mahindra. Like joined Tech Mahindra in 2018. So okay. I just left now. And before Tech Mahindra, I was in Innodatax as a network administrator. So like my role is basically like as a L3, so I mostly like do the troubleshooting part and
Okay, so why did you leave Tech Mahindra?
Yeah, I just like got the offer from SCL last month. That is why. I haven't joined SCL yet.
Okay, so any reason for applying for this one?
See, like as of now, like I haven't
multiple options.
I haven't joined the SCL yet, so I like if you to be honest, like if I getting more packet from here, then I will join here.
So this is a contracting position. I think you are aware of that.
Yeah, right? Yes, I know.
Okay, good. So this for a security position. So he'll have the technical questions.
Okay. Yeah, hi.
Yeah, hi.
Myself is this. So I'm losing you sometime. Is it the network? Is it issues with you? Was it clear all the time? It got dropped.
It was fine for me actually.
Okay, so something at my end then. good bit. So you worked on all the security devices like Palo Alto's and ASAs like that.
Yes, I do. Like I have very good experience on Cisco ASA, Palo Alto, Checkpoint, and even little about like FortiGate and Juniper SRX also.
Cool. So do you know how to upgrade the OS on the ASA firewall?
Yeah, very well.
Okay, so what is the procedure?
Yeah. So like if you have like firewall in HA, high availability, like first we copy the new image on the on the both firewall. Then we change the boot option, okay? Then we save the configuration. Then like make sure like the new image copy on the both the firewall, primary as well as the standby. So like once we copy the image and change the boot option and save the configuration, then we do the reload. First we like reload the standby box and we wait. Once we reload the standby, make sure the standby box come with the new image, boot with the new image. And like once we see, then we like on the active box we say no failover active. Is like we are making the active box as a standby. Then we reload the primary box. Once like the primary box reload and it come with the new image, then again we do the failover trigger, means like on the standby we do no failover active.
Okay, when you upgrade the secondary, the box is with the new iOS, so the primary is still with an older one.
Yes.
So will there be any mismatch on the HMD?
You will get the log like the peer has a different operating system version, because like if you want to configure the HA, this is a pre-requirement. Okay, make sure both box has the same operating system. But it's still like you getting the message, but I believe like you will not getting any, you don't require any downtime. As long as like once you see like your standby box come with the new OS, then on the active on the active box, like when you say no failover active, then the standby become active, then all the traffic will shift via through via your standby box, okay? Yeah, you, but still you get the log message, then immediately like on the primary box, okay? On the primary box, like even like in the show, like when you used the command show failover, it will show you this like mismatch error, but I believe it won't mm-hmm. be impact the traffic means as long as your standby become active. And mm-hmm. and in the show failover, you are seeing active standby.
Okay, so for example, after you upgrade both the boxes, okay, the user starts reporting that there was some couple of servers behind that firewall. Mm-hmm. This is they are not able to reach those servers. So how do you troubleshoot, and what are the things that you check from your end, and how do you prove the customer, and how do you prove that there's nothing wrong with your end and stuff like
so,
that?
So let's say like if we doing this activity, okay, operation activity, and after the activity, like the some user, if they are saying we are getting some issue, and you need to figure out like these issues related with your activity or not. Some issue like saying like we are getting some issue, then definitely first I will collect the information like which are the server, like destination IP are getting the issue, okay, and from where they are not accessible. Maybe let's say you have a server in DMG and they are not accessible mm-hmm. from the outside world, so the connection mm-hmm. is initiated from the outside world. So like in this case, like first I will collect the destination server IP detail, and then mm-hmm. we have like on the Cisco ASA firewall we have a packet tracer command. I will use the packet tracer command, like if let's say if the request coming from the outside world, so we use packet tracer mm-hmm. input input interface is outside, and source is any. And definitely like we because this was the existing session, okay, so definitely mm-hmm. you have a ACL applied on the ASA firewall, which packet is tell you like yeah this connection is already allowed. However, like the another useful command on Cisco ASA firewall, that is capture command. So capture mm-hmm. command basically show you end to end like whether you receive the traffic from the source and towards to this destination. And also like you will also see the receiving traffic or not. So like both way, incoming traffic as well as the receiving traffic through the firewall.
Okay. So for this scenario, where do you apply the packet capture?
Yeah. Let's say in this case, like the packet is coming from the outside interface and going to DMG. So mm-hmm. like once we configure the capture, give a name, then IP, host, or maybe like in this case, like let's say assume source is any destination to our DMG server. So we can apply on even on the outside interface also or DMG.
Okay. One would be good enough. So you need to have the packet capture on the both outside and the DMG interface. Okay. Right, so coming to IPsec. VPN. So have you experience working with IPsec? Okay. So what are the things that you configure in phase one and phase two on the IPsec VPN?
Yeah, if we're configuring the IPsec VPN on any firewall, like first we like define the phase one attribute, okay, where we define encryption, hashing. This is phase one, basically used for control plan, means box to box communication. And then we define mm-hmm. the phase two, okay, which is for data plan, which is the traffic which is like through the firewall, okay. And again, in the phase two, we define the attribute encryption and hashing. Then we define the, mm-hmm. Like if you're talking about policy-based VPN and IPsec policy-based VPN, then we define the interesting traffic or crypto ACL or proxy ID. Make sure this traffic should be opposite configure. Then like in Cisco ASA, we configure the crypto map. In the crypto map, basically we tie all these thing together in the crypto map, okay. Then we apply the crypto map on the outside interface. Then we initiate the interesting traffic to check whether VPN is working fine or not. Then we see show crypto Isaac amp assay for a phase one, and show crypto IPsec assay, which tell you like your traffic is properly doing encryption, decryption or not.
So after the phase one and phase two configuration, crypto map and stuff like that, what else you need to configure on the ASA firewall?
So in the ASA firewall, like I told you, like first we define the phase one attribute, mm-hmm. then authentication assay. If you're using pre-shared key, then we define tunnel group. In the tunnel group, like we define pre-shared key. Then we defined crypto ACL. Then we defined crypto map. So in the crypto map, we will say PRIP and ACL and phase two. Then we apply crypto map on the outside interface. And even like on Cisco ASA, even IsaCamp is not enabled on the outside interface. We also enable the crypto IsaCamp enable outside also.
So how about the SSL VPN troubleshooting and configuration? You worked on that?
Yeah, I know like remote access VPN, how to configure any connect VPN on the firewall. Yeah, you know, so see, like I don't know the exact command, but I know that there is one command like VPN setup, and this will tell you like what are the step if you want to configure the VPN on the Cisco ASA firewall. Yeah, I know like you first like globally you configure the web VPN, and the web and under the web VPN you define any connector should be enabled, and you define the port. Okay, then you will definitely also configure the tunnel group. So this time tunnel group is SSL for SSL. Then in the tunnel group, like you define the authentication method, like when the remote access VPN connect, okay. So your authentication method could be for a small company, they use local database, or normally like we use RADIUS server. Then we also define the group policy. So group policy that is called under the tunnel group. And even like on the group policy, you can like if you have like a multiple tunnel group, okay. So maybe like you can configure because different tunnel group has different VPN attribute, okay. Maybe different authentication method or different ACL you have configure for the user. And like as I said, like first time, like the remote access VPN, if you have like set the any connect image on your firewall, like first time, like machine on the client machine, like we open the browser, we type the firewall IP address, okay. And the first time, like even machine download the client's any connect software from the firewall, and this is like the first time. Once you download the software, okay. Then we define like the gateway IP, we say connect, okay. They will ask the prompt as the username, password. Then we, if we authenticate successfully, we get the IP address from the gateway. And also like there is a split tunneling concept, okay. So like once we connect the remote access VPN, like mostly split tunneling is disabled. That means like once your system is connected, all your traffic is going through via to your gateway, even it's an internet traffic.
So if you enable the split tunnel, all the traffic goes to the gateway?
If you disable the split tunneling, then all the traffic will go to the first gateway. Then if the destination IP, and if you do the routing for destination subnet, that is going towards to the LAN. If the user want to connect the internet, then user basically LAN to the outside interface and go to the outside interface.
So how do you disable that? How do you, what makes you to have this split tunnel enable and disable on the ASA? How do you do that?
Like this is a part of the remote access VPN configuration. I believe this configuration we need to configure either I believe that is under the group policy. So under the group policy, like there is IP split tunneling access list we define. If we define like multiple, by default, like if you're not doing this, okay, that is split tunneling disabled. But if you want to enable the split tunneling, means like once your user connect the VPN, make sure like only specific route goes towards to tunnel, and the rest of traffic will go your home PC connected by Wi-Fi, means your internet will use your Wi-Fi connection, okay. So like this will like we define one ACL, and that ACL basically we call that is basically I believe standard ACL, and we define some destination subnet, okay. So let's say our LAN is 10.0.0/16. Let's say we define one entry 10.0.0/16. Then this ACL we call under the group policy, I believe. And then we define the IP access list split tunnel and ACL value. That means once user connect, so then the gateway only send that routing towards to the client like 10.0.0/16. That for that destination traffic should go over the VPN adapter, and the rest traffic like the machine has the default routing, okay, that is towards to your Wi-Fi connect.
Okay, suppose for example you have configured everything tunnel group, you have enabled the group web policies, okay, web VPN policies and everything, okay. You created the tunnel group, you created the group policies, you have enabled the split ACLs, everything. But when the user gets connected, he's not able to ping anything on the inside interface, the servers which is behind the inside interface. So what things you will check and what else you have to verify?
So if the user is saying my VPN is connected, however, I'm not able to access the destination server which is located in our network, okay. In this case, guys, definitely first, like, I will collect the detail again, like what the user IP get when he connects the VPN, and then, like, once I know, like, this is the IP they get, okay, then I will again use the capture command, and this time I will apply the capture command on the inside interface, okay, or maybe the DMG where the server is located, okay. So I see, like, like, this is a source IP, this is a destination IP, and I configure these attributes into the capture command, okay. And then I will ask the user, can you please initiate the traffic? Because this capture command we mostly use, like, when we're doing live troubleshooting. So I ask the client, or maybe I can, like, do the testing. Like, if I also have a Cisco Connect VPN on my laptop, maybe I can ask the user, can you, like, just for the testing purpose, can you provide me that? I know this is like a security breach, okay? Like, can you share me the credentials so I can, like, test on my laptop for the troubleshooting, just a troubleshooting point? Okay.
If it is a local database, you can have your own testing user.
Yeah, maybe, like, I ask my security team or senior, like, can I get the demo, temporary user and password, because this is I require while I'm doing RABPN troubleshooting.
Okay. So once you run the packet capture, right, the status shows drop. Okay. So what could be the reasons, right?
Yeah, like if any packet drop, like, sometimes, like, I have seen, like, in the packet capture, okay, like, when the packet is initiated by the client, that means the SYN, let's say they are using some TCP application, okay. So SYN packet is passing. And sometimes I've seen, like, there is a reset packet coming from the server, okay. In this case, like, we are clearly okay, like, because firewall in the middle, they are not resetting the packet, okay. We are seeing the resetting, our packet means reset packet from the server itself, okay. So this means, like, if I see this thing, okay, like SYN or R packet, I have seen, like, a lot of time. In this case, guys, like, we clearly tell the user, like, this needs to be checked at server side,
okay. For example, in the same it says the drop says at the NAT level. So what is the issue?
NAT level, then I need to figure out means like do we require NATing for this flow or not, like, because, like, the so I definitely in this case, guys, I believe, like, the packet tracer will help us, because it will also show you, like, what could be the reason why I'm dropping the packet on the firewall.
Yeah, so the packet tracer is still saying you did the drop at the NAT level.
Yeah, then I will see, like, I will check the NAT configuration for the flow, particular source and destination IP, what are the NAT rule configure, and when they are communicate, okay, which IP we use for the translation, okay, and do we require or not NAT, okay. Like, sometimes seen I have, like, some VPN, they are getting the issue because of NAT rule, okay. Because I have seen, like, means, okay, because NATing and routing check first before VPN, okay. So in this case, guys, like, if you're talking about the remote access VPN, okay, and I see traffic is going, or it's NATing happening, and this cause some VPN issue, then I will see, like, whether NATing is required or not. Then maybe I will do NATing. I will create for NAT exemption rule for that source and destination.
Does it really required or not to have an SSL remote access to VPN?
So
NAT is required. Or not?
NAT, because NATing is checked first, okay, so I believe you require NAT exemption rule for like you.
Okay,
you will create, like, let's say the whatever the VPN pool you use for RABPN, okay, so then you can define, means, like, when this source communicate with our destination subnet, we don't need a NAT rule, okay? So we maybe we like on the top, we will place the NAT exempt rule.
All right, moving on to Palo Alto. Mm-hmm. So you have working experience with Palo Alto?
Yes.
So how do you upgrade a Palo Alto box? Just think that's just a standalone box. So what is the procedure?
Yeah, like.
And what are the pre-checks you'll do?
In the device tab, like definitely first, like I will take the backup of the firewall, okay? Then like first, mm-hmm. like on the device, like there is like I believe when it's software tab, okay, in the under the device is software, we see like we check like it will show you like all the update, okay, means like these are the mm-hmm. Latest version. So we download that, then install that simply by clicking mm-hmm. on the Palo Alto.
Okay, right. So before you download or install, do we need to check something on the Palo Alto?
We can also check like what country version we are using and what is the latest version we are going, okay? And can we go directly from my current version to the new version, okay?
All right. So what is the command to check the sessions on the Palo Alto from the CLI?
Show session all, I believe.
Okay. What is VWire on the Palo Alto?
Yeah, VWire is also known as bumping wire, and mm-hmm. like we configure two interface. Okay, they will like once you configure two interface in VWire, like whatever the traffic you will get on, let's say interface one, it will forward the traffic without checking routing or layer two addresses. Okay, so you can say like this is transparent firewall, something like similar like. But in Cisco ASA, like there is like completely, if you change the transparent mode, okay, then firewall completely become a transparent, okay, means they will forward the traffic just like a bridging, okay. But in Palo Alto, like if you have a four interface, okay, two interface maybe you can use as a layer three, or two interface if you're using mm-hmm. virtual wire. So this means like mm-hmm. whatever the traffic we get without check the routing, we forward the traffic.
Okay, so moving on to the switching. So you have exposure working with switching also,
yes,
right?
Yes, very well.
So have you, what are the platforms that you worked on?
Yeah, I work on even enterprise like 45-6500 switches, even below like distribution 3700, and even access switches like 2900. And even I have a good experience on data center like Nexus 2K, 5K, 7K, but not 9K, means ACI.
Okay. So, all right. So can you explain me the procedure to upgrade an iOS on the Catalyst devices?
Yeah. These days, like we are using packages for like upgrading the switches. Okay. Like there is one command like install command. We like first we. Copy the new image definitely, then we extract that, okay, and we install the packages, okay. So this is the new way. However, the older way, we copy the command into the flash, okay, then we change the boot option and save the mm-hmm. configuration and reload the box.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so how you do the same thing when you have a stack of devices? How it differs from the...
Yeah.
Upgrading
with the stack devices, like if you have a switch in stack and you are planning to do upgrade, in this case, guys, like first, like again, we copy the image into the flash, and even in the second flash also, because like once you have a switch in stack, one become master and other one become a standby. So once we copy the image, mm-hmm. we change the boot option, we save the configuration, then we use reload. Switch number. So like when you do show switch, okay, if you have a two switch, okay, mm-hmm. it will show you the switch number, okay, switch one, switch two. This will show you like switch one is master or switch two is a standby. So when you're using the reload command, okay, you will use reload slot then the switch number, okay. If you say definitely first you will reload the standby, then when the standby come up with the new OS, then you will do the reload slot one for the primary.
Okay, so what is that the packages file that you're talking about?
Right?
What is the packages file that we extract? What is called and how it helps to?
Yeah, I see like especially like 9300 or 9200 switches. Okay, they using the install method. Okay, I forget means like why they are using, but I know like basically we use first we copy the maze, then we install the package, okay, then they behind the scene they reboot the box, okay, and then they come with new mazes, okay. Means I have done it, but
it is not just pertaining to the device model. It is something to do with an iOS version, okay. There are two in the packages that you do it's an install mode, we call it,
right.
and it, that to do that there are two different variations on the different group iOS. Okay, so you says you work on Nexus also, right? Yeah. So how do you upgrade on a Nexus device? Suppose you got a 3K device, okay. So what are the things you have to upgrade on the Nexus device? As you do it, iOS upgrade on the Catalyst devices, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what extra thing that you have on the Nexus?
I know like it has basically two part in the OS, okay. One is kernel image, and
kernel image.
No, means like there is I believe there is two part like in the image, okay. To be honest, okay, I haven't did that, okay. Means like I know what is VPC, what is fabric path, and how VPC work, okay, and how fabric path work. So these things, but I haven't like done this thing, okay.
Okay. So what is the similar technology that you have in the the district this one 6500 as VPC?
Yeah, VSS, virtual switch system. So just tagging VSS, VPC, basically all these three technology providing us multi chassis channel MLAG.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. So how about the routing set? You worked on the routers and stuff like that.
Well. BGP, OSP. Mostly like people are using BGP or OS.
Okay, so why we need actually the OSPF when we have on a BGP?
So,
can we run the network on the BGP? Just BGP?
Yeah, like I believe like even most people are running BGP over any other routing protocol. The reason like in BGP we can modify the path per subnet basis, okay, whereas OSPF or EIGRP they totally depend on the link. Suppose like if we have a router with has a two link, and from the both link we are getting the same subnet, okay. So whatever the cost, like in the OSP, whatever the cost value you set for the link one, let's say lower value, all the traffic will go via link one. And same case with EIGRP. EIGRP also depend on the bandwidth and link delay. But in BGP, we can modify the path. Like I have seen, like when we have a MPLS connection, okay. Let's say we are two MPLS connection, obviously for the redundancy purpose, okay. And over the from PE to CE, we can run any routing, static, OSPF, EIGRP, BGP. But still, people are preferring BGP. That's the main reason. In BGP, the path selection means like we can do per subnet piece routing. Okay, means one subnet traffic going via ISP1 and second subnet traffic going via ISP2. So that's the reason, okay, like BGP is very rich in path attribute, okay. And second thing I have seen, like in BGP, we can also influence that reverse traffic even if we are sitting on one side, okay. As outgoing traffic also, as well as the incoming traffic also. But in case of OSPF or EIGRP, like let's say we have a router one and router two, these two router connected via two link. If we like, if we sitting on the router one, and from the router one perspective, if we want to modify our incoming traffic, then definitely we need to go on a router two and change the link host. Okay, but in BGP, if you're sitting on router one, still you can modify your incoming traffic while doing the changes on the router one.
Okay, so what are the attributes that you do?
Yeah.
What attribute you apply?
So like in BGP, like if you want to modify your outgoing traffic, okay, we mostly use either weight or local preference. And however, the routing policy, yani route map, we applied always for inbound. So this is opposite, okay? Like if you want to modify your outbound traffic, your route map applied in inbound track. And for the let's say if you want to modify your incoming traffic, then we use the attribute like AS path list or MET, means BGP metric. Then when we want to modify your incoming traffic, okay, then the route map we applied outbound track, because the traffic flow or routing update. Okay, these are opposite.
Okay, so if you manipulate the route with the weight, so will it be applicable to all the neighboring devices?
No, locally on the router, it's a Cisco proprietary, like we mostly use, that's why local preference. Local preference impacts
so
the whole AS.
What attributes helps you to?
Whole AS.
So what attribute we need to manipulate the route with all the neighbors?
So when you're running the BGP over the internet, okay, it means you purchase your own public pool, okay, from the, like, if you're a company in India, you will like get the, your own public pool from Appnik, okay. In this case, like if you want your whole AS traffic will go via ISP1, you will use a local preference.
Okay, all right. So how does BGP loop prevention mechanism works actually?
Yeah, loop prevention is work in BGP, like in eBGP. In eBGP, mm-hmm. loop prevention happened through the AS path list,
mm-hmm.
and in IBGP, IBGP loop prevention happened because of the split-Hoyerian rule.
Okay, so what it does like in IBGP, how it
I'll like clear you this thing, okay, like with the diagram, but I tell you like, what is the split-Hoyerian rule, and sometimes like this mm-hmm. split-Hoyerian rule creates some problem, okay, then we have a solution, full mesh, BGP confederation or BGP route factor, okay, but like the split-Hoyerian rule basically tells like when you get the route from IBGP, don't send to the another IBGP. Sometime like we get the issue, and for that we have a solution, full mesh or BGP confederation, or we can use a BGP router factor, okay.
All right, so you have experience working with SSRP?
Yeah, very well.
Okay, so suppose you got two routers, okay, you configure the two routers with the same priority, uh-huh. what will happen?
Yeah, it will like the other, the router which has the highest IP address, that become the active one.
No,
either highest or lowest, okay, but because basically like the router which we want to make active, okay, definitely we will increase the priority value, okay. I know like HSRP highest is better, our priority, mm-hmm. but IP address, I forget, maybe it's the lowest but highest. So but the point is, if both router has the same IP address, then sorry, same priority, then one become active, okay. I believe it depend on the lowest IP, highest IP address or the highest IP address.
Okay. not that true, but something else. Okay, so what is the default priority?
Sorry?
Of the SSRP. What is the default priority of SSRP? And what are the stages that it goes through when it's negotiating with the peer SSRP states?
Yeah. Hello packet they are sending every 3 seconds, and hold down time it is 9 seconds. Mm-hmm. I don't know this, like whatever, I forget the stages, okay. So, but I know like they use UDP port 1985. I have seen the scenario, mm-hmm. like we were running HSRP on the SBI interface on the course, which is okay. And on the, mm-hmm. the SBI, they have applied one ACL, and they forget to allow the port UDP 1985. And as a result, like both cores which showing active. Okay, mm-hmm. then once I check, like both are showing active, then we figure out like ACL is basically blocking the UDP port 1985, which is required for HSRP mm-hmm. to communication these two mm-hmm. boxes, okay. So then mm-hmm. once we allow it, okay, then it will like properly sync, okay, like one become active and other one become standby.
Okay, cool. Right, cool. So I'm done. Ibrahim, if you have something, you can go ahead.
Yeah, I just have like only one question, like what will be the ship timing here?